everyone, in today's video we are going to be talking all about nursing ethics. If you've not heard of this, where have you been? That's all I seem to have heard during my nursing career, all about ethics. But what is it? Why is it? We're going to find out in this vlog. So firstly, ethics is actually a Greek word for ethos, and ethos means character. Ethical values are almost like a code of conduct in a way, and these provide a basis of what that person's actions, intentions, and motives are value to that person. All about right or wrong actions, decision making, and the consequences of those actions that you're taking. And we'll all have different morals, we'll all have different ethics, we'll all have different beliefs and cultures. And it's really important that we try and get these ethics that we possess ourselves into a more neutral position, that we can care for everybody and anybody, regardless of what the other person might believe, for example. It's really, really important that sometimes we have to put our own judgments and morals aside for a patient. If they're making a decision that you might not agree with, I've talked about this before, patient might make a decision that you're thinking, oh, that's a really bad decision, but that doesn't make it a wrong decision. It is that patient's choice at the end of the day, and it's important that you maintain your values and your ethical stance and, yeah, support the patient. So here are some ethical concepts for you. I've taken these from the RCNI. They do an amazing journal on this, which I'll post the link below so you can have a proper read of. Avoiding harm. This should be in every decision you make. Is this decision I'm about to make going to harm my patient? It's as simple as that. And this underpins good healthcare practice. And this is exactly why we always go on evidence-based practice as well. The research is out there for everything we do, or most things that we do. So it's really important to go by evidence-based practice to make sure that that harm is completely avoided. Moral obligations and duties. So as a nurse, you should always be doing the thing that's the right thing to do. This isn't the right thing to do in your mind, it's the right thing to do in nursing. So something that you might think is right might not actually be right. So this is why, again, it's important to follow evidence-based practice. You're weighing up all of the options in your mind to put together a picture for the patient, or a care plan, or a management plan, something like that in place. You're getting all that evidence to do the right thing for your patient. So what is going to be the best outcome for your patient? And that leads me very nicely on to the next one, assessing the consequences of the actions. So you are going to, when you're making a decision, again, you're thinking, what is the best outcome for the patient? Not for you, not for your colleagues. What is the best outcome to help this patient? And that's going to decide your consequences of your actions and hopefully prevent harm. Autonomy and rights. So as a nurse, you should be able to work autonomously. I can never say this word, but that just means you can think for yourself, you can weigh up the options, you can look at the evidence, research-based practice, you're free from influence from other people around you. You're making that decision with, or sometimes on behalf of your patient. You're acting as an advocate sometimes for your patient, and you have to do that as an independent, confident, competent person. And what about rights? So what do you think, what sort of rights do you think that you have as a nurse? This is a tricky one, actually, because we don't often think of us having rights. We always think about patients' rights and what's best for the patient. But let's just say a patient came to you and they asked for double the dose of their morphine because they wanted to kill themselves or something like that. You know that that's not right. So you know that the right thing for you to do and the rights that you have is not to give that to the patient. If it's going to cause harm to the patient, you don't do it, and that is your right. You can't get struck off for being a safe nurse. You can't get struck off for evidence-based practice, and you can't get struck off for avoiding harm to your patient. But yeah, but have a little think about that and let me know in the comments below, what rights do you think that nurses have? And you're more than welcome to put some funny answers. That's fine. Best interest. So we just briefly spoke about this, as like acting as an advocate for your patient. So you must always do what's in the best interest of your patient, not what's for you, not what's for your colleagues. Again, best interests for your patient. And I'm going to give you a little an example here. So as a student nurse on my very first placement that shall never be named, I worked with a lovely being a little bit sarcastic, healthcare assistant, who always did what was right for them, always did what's in the best interest of them, not the patient. And this one day, I said to a patient, you know, do you want to wear your own clothes today? And they said, yeah, that'd be really, really nice. I'll feel a bit more human again. Perfect. That's what I want to hear. Fantastic. I've given the patient their choice and their dignity back. Anyway, dressed the patient. They looked amazing. They had the shirt on. They looked fabulous. And you could see by their face, they actually looked a little bit relieved as well. They didn't have to wear those pajamas anymore. Anyway, this healthcare assistant comes along, looks at the patient, looks at me and says, why have you dressed this patient? Quite loudly in front of everybody in the bay. And I said, I gave him the choice and he wanted to wear his clothes. And she said, well, it's easier for us if you put them in our hospital gowns or pajamas, because now we're going to have to take it all off when we change the catheters and blah, blah, blah. What? Who is that in the best interest of? Because it is not the patient at all. And I literally just looked at her and I said, well, I gave the patient choice and their dignity back, and I walked away. She never spoke to me again for the rest of that day. Because do you know what? It's in my best interest to do the best that I can for my patients. I'm not there to keep people happy. I'm not there to please the healthcare assistants or the nurses or the doctors or the top consultants. If I'm doing my best for my patients, that is the best that I can be, and that's the best that I can do. And I'm giving you this advice too. Don't do things because someone else has told you to. If it's not right, don't do it. Next up, we have values and beliefs. So we've briefly spoke about this at the beginning. So your values and your beliefs should never get in the way of making these best interest decisions. They should never get in the way of the patient care that you're given. You know, and your values and beliefs when you're working as a nurse, should always be about the patient. It should always be about patient safety, maintaining, keeping that patient well, preventing harm, like we've spoke about. And you should have that good ethical decision and actions as your values and beliefs. Emotions, relationships and context. Now, this is a tricky one, because if you've got a lot going on at home, you've got relationship breakdowns and you're going into work already in that mindset and that bad mood, do you think that's going to affect your decisions that you make that day? Is it going to affect the patient care that you're giving that day because you're having a bad day? The answer should be no, because you shouldn't be letting anything from your home life or personal life come into effect in work. You should always be thinking about the patient, always keeping them safe. And it can be hard if you are feeling so low inside and you've got that mentality that you don't want to be at work. It can be really hard to push that aside and do the best. So it's really important, if you are having struggles or anything like that, to firstly speak up about it, get support and get some help, and maybe take some time off as well so that you can recharge and come back being your best self, so that you can create this positive and safe environment for your patient. Moral character. So for this one, I'm going to break it down into two sections. So moral relates to your beliefs of what is right or wrong, and then character is all of the qualities a person has to distinct them from one person to another person. So put them both together and you have moral character. So something that makes somebody like a good person, someone that may do the right thing rather than the wrong thing, depends what the right or wrong thing is, that sort of thing is moral character. And I just wanted to add here, you know, sometimes we all make mistakes. Sometimes we all get it wrong. It doesn't mean that you're a bad person. It doesn't mean that you're less of a nurse for it. You know, it is life. It's the way that life is. Sometimes we might make a decision and it might go horribly wrong, but you've acted in the best interest of your patient. You've followed the evidence, the best evidence practice, and it can still go wrong. But as long as you can show your rationale behind your decisions, that you're acting in the best interest of the person, then don't worry. You know, mistakes do happen. Mistakes have happened to me. I'm sure they've happened to you already. And that's okay. Be kind to yourselves. So as I was doing a little bit of research around ethics in nursing, I found a really good code of ethics from the American Nurses Association Code of Ethics for Nurses. So I'm just going to read some of them out and see what you think. I've got my laptop here. I will put the links below, though, if you want to read yourself, that's fine. So provision one, the nurse practices with compassion and respect for inherent dignity, worth and unique attributes of every person. I'd say that was a good one. Provision 2. The nurse's primary commitment is to the patient, whether an individual, family, group, community, or population. Interesting. For me, this is a 50-50 one, because sometimes, what if the family are causing the problem to the patient, if that makes sense? And you have to think about safeguarding and stuff like that. So, yeah, absolutely, we will get the whole family involved in decision making, patient care, like family meetings and hospitals and things like that. But if there was a concern, obviously your whole focus isn't going to be on the whole family. Provision 3. The nurse promotes, advocates for, and protects the rights, health, and safety of the patient. Yes, that is right. Provision 4. The nurse has authority, accountability, and responsibility for nursing practices, decisions, and takes actions consistent with the obligation to provide optimal patient care. Yes, every nurse should take accountability for their actions. 100% agree. Provision 5. Oh, how many are there? There's 9. Provision 5. The nurse owes the same duties to self as others. Oh, yes. Including the responsibility to promote health and safety, preserve wholeness of character, integrity, maintain competence, and continue personal and professional growth. Yes, I think that's one of my favourite ones, because we should all be looking after ourselves as much as we look after the patients. Thank you. Thank you. Provision 6. The nurse, through individual and collective effort, establishes, maintains, and improves ethical environment of work, of the work setting, and conditions of employment are conducive to safe, quality healthcare. Yes, I think every nurse should be doing that as well. Absolutely agree with that one. Provision 7, the nurse in all roles and settings advances the profession through research and scholarly inquiry, professional standards development, and the generation of both nursing and health policy. Well, yeah, we should be doing that. We should all be following evidence-based practice and research and all that jazz. So yes, that is also in the UK, guys. Provision 8. The nurse collaborates with other healthcare professionals and the public to protect human rights, promote health diplomacy, and reduce health disparities. Yes, we do that anyway. Provision 9, last but not least, guys. The profession of nursing, collectively through its professional organisation, must articulate nursing values, maintain the integrity of the profession, and integrate principles of social justice into nursing and health policy. Again, we do this anyway. Like, we've got the NMC Nursing Code of Conduct we have to follow, and this talks about this at all times, upholding the profession, being professional on social media, etc. Absolutely. So the wonderful people at the RCN have created this really good guide that I've just found, and it's called, this is it, this is what it looks like. Have a look at it. I'll put the links below. But there's a really good thing on when to go out on placement. So this talks about finding out the trust set of values and principles and how you can meet these whilst you're on placement. Beautiful. And how do these values sort of coincide with ethics and principles of nursing, that sort of thing, NMC code of conduct, and what are the themes that you can pull out from these values? Find out how quality and safety are monitored, and in particular how this is going to be fed back to the staff as well. So are there any audits that are done, CQC reports, things like that, and are they reported back to the nurses? Have a look at the recent patient surveys that have been done. What's good, what's bad, what can be improved? Have a look at that, because that will sort of guide you as well and what sort of area you're looking at. When you're on placement, have a look around. Are these people that you're working with upholding the trust values? Have a look. Is there any actions that can be taken from this? And if there are any actions that you've noticed, how do you bring that up in placement? Who do you speak to? You know, because these conversations can be difficult. It's really hard to go somewhere where they've worked for years and years and years, and sometimes they don't realise what's going on and what's happening because they're just doing the same thing. They're on autopilot every single day, so they don't realise sometimes what's happening, or the change needs to be made, for example. So those conversations can be really hard. So think about what you might say to somebody or management, or setting up a meeting with staff to talk about it. How would you deal with that? And when you go back to university and you're moving on to your next placement, keep these principles and values in mind. How do they differ between trusts and placements? It's a really good thing. And you'll find actually there are some similarities and there are some themes that run through everybody's trusts and values. And a lot of it is about best care and patient safety. And actually on this PDF file, there's really good reflective questions for students about episodes of care. So maybe this could be something that you could fill out whilst you're on placement. And at the end of your placement, you could hand it to the manager because, I mean, you're not going to see them again and you don't have to work with these people again. But if there's stuff there that, I mean, it talks about what stood out for you, what positive things, that's a really good thing to feed back to people. What have you noticed from the values of the trust that are being implemented in that practice? Again, really good stuff to be putting in there. Are there any areas that are concerning or could be improved on? Again, a really nice question. You know, it's not targeting anyone. It's not causing trouble. You're just putting areas for improvement. I think this is a really good document. If you've got any concerns or anything on placements and you don't feel confident enough to speak up, this is a really good way to do it. I think print this out, fill it out and hand it in, put it on the desk or something to the manager when you leave. And you can probably just do it anonymously as well. Just drop it in and then it's planted that seed then for them to think, oh, I need to look at this. I'm on it, guys. So going back to the RCNI and ethics, whatever I was speaking about, there's a really good case scenario here. And I just want to run through it with you because it's a really, really good one and it does make you think. So this case scenario, I'm going to read it from my screen again because maybe I'll do it this way so I'm not looking that over there. I don't know how to do this, guys. See, this is why I don't plan vlogs or have a script because it just goes wrong. So George, age 70, recently underwent abdominal surgery when it was discovered that he had a carcinoma of the stomach, so cancer in the stomach. It was not possible to remove this tumour and there was an evidence of secondary cancerous growth in the liver, so this is spreading, it's getting worse for the guy. George's family have been informed of the prognosis. They have requested that he, George, should not be told the truth until it's absolutely necessary. What would you do? Now, the thing for me, this poses more questions to me than anything else. And the answer isn't here. There is a lot of questions. But my question would be, okay, firstly, does George have capacity? Has he got capacity to understand the information you're giving him? And is this information going to cause way more distress than necessary to this patient? So if this patient has capacity, they understand fully what's going on. I'm sorry, you cannot withhold information from your patient. It's all about, you know, we spoke about ethics and truth telling and the rights and best interests of the patient. Is it in the best interest of the patient? Yes, because this patient needs to make a decision. This patient needs to make a decision about their care they're going to receive, the treatment that they're going to receive. They're going to have to make the decision about maybe end of life care, putting a do not attempt resuscitation in place if that's what they wanted. There's 101 things that this patient needs to be involved with, and you can't withhold this information just because the family aren't happy with it. However, on the flip side, if this patient was, you know, they had later stages of dementia, they're not going to fully understand this information. It's going to cause way more distress than necessary. And you've got the family as the power of attorney and things like that. Then you might think slightly different about it. I know I would definitely think slightly different about it. And I'd be weighing up these options with the family, with my colleagues, with the consultants as well, to make the best decision in the best interests of that patient. That's just my thoughts around it. My thoughts might not be right. They might be wrong. Who knows? But yeah, again, comment below. Let me know what you think about this scenario. What would you do? What is the best thing for this patient in this scenario? And also my last question for this is, why have the family been told but not George yet? Why is that? What's happened there? Surely the patient should be the first one to know, unless again, they've got power of attorney, they've got dementia, they haven't got capacity, then you might go to the family member instead. But I wanna know why. Why has the family been told? Has confidentiality been broken in this case? Those little things. Okay, I think I've covered enough on ethics. I think I've covered as much as I can without boring you to death. But I think it's a really, really interesting discussion actually, and some really good food for thought as well along with it. Think about what you do in your practice. Think about what ethical decisions that you might have to make. Have a think about different scenarios like George and how you would handle them. But most of all, think about just being a good nurse. Always act in the best interest of your patient, the safest way possible. And if, as long as you're doing that and you can rationalize every single decision you make, you're on to a winner, guys. So go out there, keep being amazing. You've got this.